It was great to be invited here to talk about this topic that has been quite interesting to me for a long time. And so the title of my talk is Configuring MIMO Communication Links with Machine Learning. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you some of my perspectives about the role of machine learning, in particular in MIMO communication. And so I'm going to start off with a discussion of some of the work that I did with one of my students in the past about, about 10 years ago now, on link adaptation in a MIMO communication system. And then I'm going to switch to tell you about some of the more recent work that we've done in applying machine learning techniques to beam training in millimeter wave systems. And then I'll wrap up with a couple highlights of other directions that I think are interesting. So I'm going to start off with an introduction to MIMO link adaptation and explain the role of machine learning here. And I should say that a lot of these results here are summarized from one of my students' dissertations. And this was a strange thing because normally in our department, the dissertation is basically a bunch of journal papers put together with an introduction. But I found in this guy's dissertation, he had a bunch of extra work and results. And so it was really interesting, and it was quite fun to read after, a number of years. I don't think I've ever reread any of my students' dissertations, I have to say. So I'm going to start off with a bit of background about link adaptation. So if you take a wireless communications course and you study link adaptation, the explanation will be something along the lines as follows here. So you have like a wireless communication system, there's a slow fading channel, and the SNR is varying over time. And so the idea is that at the receiver, if you could estimate the SNR and tell the transmitter what the SNR is, then the transmitter could adapt the transmission parameters like code rate, modulation order, such that you could send as high of a data rate as possible while still meeting an error rate target. And so for example, the left here is a bit error rate plot, and you can see that we have a target of 10 to minus 3 bit error rate, that red line. And so if you measure an SNR of 15 dB, then you would select the lowest rate that's meeting the BDR threshold, which would be the QPSK signal. And if your SNR is like 22 dB, then you would select 16 watt. And then the data rate is going to be below the target everywhere except for very low SNRs where you just don't have any choice. So that's like picking the modulation order. And so the advantage of picking a higher modulation order is you send more bits per symbol and the data rate's higher. Now on the right plot, you see this is 64 QAM with three different code rates. And so when you have error control coding in this simple setting, changing the code rate changes the SNR threshold. And so you could have various modulations, various code rates, and then depending on the SNR, you could pick the one that's closest and that would give you the highest throughput or good voter spectral efficiency, depending on what you're using here. Now, in MIMO communications, this simple idea of link adaptation actually is much more difficult. And in particular, I'm talking about MIMO systems here like 11N or 11AC, where you're doing your coding across the entire frequency band. You're not doing something like what's happening in 4G, where you do OFDMA and you assign users to subsets of carriers. So what happens is, so you have frequency selectivity in the channel. So some subcarriers are good, some are bad. And you also have MIMO. So you have the ability to do pre-coding with one stream, two streams, three streams. So you can adapt the rank to the channel. So now in addition to coding modulation, you also have this MIMO configuration too that has to be done. And there's potentially other configurations that could happen as well. You could have things like power control, you could change the pre-coder, you could even adapt the bandwidth here. But the net of it is that, when you try to really build a system with MIMO link adaptation, you find that it's pretty tough. And the theory is not really there to help you because it becomes hard to do even simple tasks like if I have a frequency selective channel, 64 QAM, two streams of MIMO, 4x4 system with pre-coding, it's very hard to predict the packet error rate or the bit error rate in that setting. We have good bounds for it, we can compute dimensional information, but actually getting the error rate is tough. So as a result, there was a lot of work on trying to put the MIMO approach and try to shoehorn it in to the CISO setting. And so I have a bunch of tiny equations up here that probably not even the front row you can see, but basically The approach was as follows. You take your MIMO channel estimates. Now let's say an 11N system, you have 52 subcarriers. Maybe you have a 4x4 channel. So you have 4 × 4 × 52. These are complex. We multiply times 2 coefficients in your channel, plus 1 for the noise power. And so all of that information gets squeezed into a number, which is usually something like an effective SNR. And the idea is we shoehorn this into an SNR so that we can use the same trick as before, which is basically a lookup table. And so there's all kinds of metrics, and then you would compute in MIMO, typically the SNR is a post-processing SINR. So it's on per stream, after the pre-coding and the equalization, you get an SNR. So you have an SNR per screen, per subcarrier. And so there's things like average SNR, minimum capacity, average capacity, minimum SNR. The ones that are used most in industry are either effective exponential SNR mapping or mean mutual information. And mean mutual information is probably the one that is maybe most common in the sense, so it's like you say, okay, I have the sum of a bunch of log of 1 plus SINRs, and I'm going to make them equal to another log of 1 plus SINR. So you try to pick a number that matches the sum. So basically, you end up with a one-dimensional proxy that goes into a lookup table that pops out the rate. So you measure the channel, get this number, hit the lookup table, get the coding modulation and number of streams. Now, the challenge is, there's quite a few here. Well, one is that you have to tune that table quite a bit, depending on your metric, and depending on your channels. And when you get into different environments, different antenna configurations, that table may not work well. There's other things as well. So what I have up here is a BER plot for, I forget the coding here, but it's with a wrap, a power amplifier with different levels of nonlinearity. And so you can see that depending on the power amplifier coefficients, the BER curve for one single modulation coding changes substantially. So if you were building your lookup table around, you know, dB thresholds, and you happen to have more nonlinearity in the RF than you expected, then the entire table could be off. And so that's a problem. You can see here the span is something like 10 or 10 plus dB. Now, of course, you know, you would like to have no nonlinearity, but then you talk to your circuits friends, well, that's really expensive, a lot of power. So they want to have a lot of nonlinearity. You know, there's always a back and forth. And also, the person that makes the chip may not be the same as the person that's making the power amplifier. So basically, there's model mismatch when you have this lookup table approach. So the approach that we decided to take here was to use machine learning. And I'm putting shallow here because that's what we were using. You know, when we did this work originally in 2008 timeframe, deep learning wasn't a big hot topic. And the basic concept is as follows. So there's different kinds of learning. There's supervised, unsupervised, and reinforcement. So the supervised learning, you have data, labels, and then you try to train the, in this case, the classifier to based on the data, the training data, label data that you have. And unsupervised learning tries to figure the labels out itself. And reinforcement learning is going to update the way that it learns over time. And I'm going to tell you a little bit later about how we use reinforcement learning. But right now I'm going to explain the approach from a supervised classification perspective. So the way typical classifiers work, there's raw data goes in to some sort of a front end that performs what's called feature extraction. And so the objective of that front end is to reduce the dimensionality of the incoming data. So in the examples I gave you before, the roughly 1,000 dimensional MIMO vector was squeezed into one dimension. And now I want to allow perhaps a few dimensions to give a little bit more flexibility to the classifier. Classifier takes that low dimensional vector and assigns to it a label. And that label is the class. And then we're going to train that classifier based on the past performance data to do its job. And then what I'm calling here the shallow part is that we're going to use expert knowledge, in particular communication theory. You know, I think there's a lot of debate about whether we still need theory, communication theory, you know, if the AI is just going to do everything for us. I really hope that's not the case, otherwise they're going to eventually do the professor's job too, and we won't have any jobs. So, in this case here, we used our knowledge about how MIMO OFDM works to design a special front end to reduce the dimensionality of the feature vector, in the end to four dimensions. And then we used experiments to tweak it a bit, and then based on that, we did classification. And then when you take the approaches that are based more on deep learning, often those approaches will do the this front end as well. So they'll do the feature extraction as part of the learning process. You don't have to send in a low-dimensional data. You can send in high-dimensional vector. And then there's another deep aspect in the classifier. The approaches I took here were simple, using either nearest neighbors or support vector machines. We didn't use like a convolutional neural network approach, which would also be deep. So, you know, how does this relate to MIMO-FDM? Well, the input was that 1,000-dimension vector. The feature was going to be potentially greater than one. We could make the feature dimension one, and then we could get maybe a generalization of those other metrics I showed you. And then the class was going to be a code rate, a modulation order, and a number of streams. So it could be 16 QAM, rate 2/3, and two streams, for example. That would be a class label. And so the kind of training data we have is we have the processed channel information that becomes our feature vector. We have a coding modulation number of streams. And then we have if that packet was decoded correctly or not. And the nice thing is that in wireless, especially like in wireless LAN in particular, you append a CRC to all of the packets. And so you get for free information about whether it was decoded correctly or not. And so this is data that you can easily measure in a wireless system. And then the classifiers we use nearest neighbors, which is like the, you know, kind of the baby classifier. And then we use later work, the support vector machine. And the support vector machine, I'm actually explain the equation here, but basically it's going to fit a thresholding, so you can decide whether the given, according to the given feature, corresponds to a given class or not. And so we could use it, for example, to say, okay, does this observed channel satisfy the frame error rate constraint with 64 QAM, two streams, rate 2/3 code, yes or no? And then with a whole bunch of these classifiers, we could then determine which modulation codings and streams satisfy the rate requirement, and then we pick the error rate requirement, and then we pick the one with the highest throughput. So that's the key idea. Now, the engineering part, this was the thing that, you know, we came up with just in trying to figure out how to solve the problem, and of course trying the brute force approach, which, you know, didn't work. So our observation was as follows. So let's look at like the SIMR profile for a typical OFDM system, where you're just going to dispense with MIMO for the moment here. And so you see that there's places where there's fades, right? Like here, there's a fade. There, the signal is quite amplified. And so kind of intuitively, if we had no coding, we'd say, ah, that fade is going to determine the performance of our system. But then the problem is we have coding. So you might think, well, maybe I have a Reed Solomon code, I can correct 3 subcarrier errors, so maybe it's like the 4th worst subcarrier. But it's not quite that simple, because if the errors are grouped together, then maybe the code doesn't work as well. So we tried various approaches here, and after thinking about it for a while, what we realized was, because we were focusing on the 11N system, which had convolutional coding, interleaving, and symbol modulation, what we realized was that the ordering doesn't matter. You know, because of the interleaving, it shouldn't matter whether the fade is on subcarrier 4 or subcarrier 16. They should, in principle, have the same effect if your interleaver was good. And so what we decided to do was decided to sort. Now remember, sort is a nonlinear operation. So we decided to sort the subcarriers from worst to best, and then build our feature vector by taking samples of that sorted subcarrier profile. And then this is where the, you know, engineering and the, you know, grad students spent a lot of time messing around with it, was to figure out, you know, what subcarriers to take and how many to grab. And so through experimentation and implementation, we converged on a solution where we would build that feature vector from 4 SMR values. And the numbers are actually up there. I can't read them here, but it was something like, this is an example of like the first 7th, 14th and 20th worst. I don't remember if that was the one that we used most of the time, but it was something along those lines. It wasn't necessarily the worst one, wasn't the best, it was some in the middle. And so that was our engineering insight that went into designing that front end, so then we could pop that into a off-the-shelf machine learning classifier. Okay, so how did we incorporate MIMO? Well, we took the post-processing SINR, sorted it in the way I just described, And then when we had multiple streams, we took the minimum of the SINRs and just did the same thing. And so we didn't try to average or combine, we just used the minimum. And then we applied the classifier to each of those different feature vectors with the idea of determining for every number of streams the coding and modulation that you might want to use, and then at the end, we find the one that meets the maximum rate, still meeting the predicted error rate target. So that was the MIMO extension. Now, this is an example of performance in AU211N channel model B. And the x-axis here is SNR, average SNR. The y-axis is spectral efficiency. So if you look at it like a link adaptation paper, most of them have this kind of a plot. If you were looking at a MAC type paper, it would be something that's closer to good put, but it has these general characteristics here. So you've got average SNR, and then depending on the SNR, you have different rates, and depending on how many rates you have, that curve could be kind of bumpy or smoother. The black curve there is the rate that we get if we select perfectly after the fact. So you basically get a channel, you simulate all the possible rates, and you pick the best one. That's the spectral efficiency that you would get. And then the red one is if we use the minimum capacity proxy. The average capacity is this dashed one, you probably can't see. The purple one is EESM. These, by the way, all of these approaches, we optimized also with the machine learning, to be fair. So we didn't pick a lookup table from a paper, we optimized the lookup table to make sure it worked. And that was, we thought that was the right thing to do. And then the green curve is the approach that we had developed here. And you can see at low SNR, the gap isn't that significant. And higher SNRs, you can get several dB improvement over the other approaches that we also had optimized, but had only one-dimensional features. So this was, very promising for us to be able to use this machine learning and actually improve over the state of the art in a way that, that actually gave performance, even when we did the best we could do with one dimension. Now, this is all an example where we're using just supervised learning. There was, we train the system, and then we run it on a set of channels. So the later work, what we wanted to do was to figure out, okay, so suppose that you have impairments in your system, like you have this nonlinearity that varies with temperature, varies over time. So can we develop an online method so we can take the information that we have, so we're communicating, right? We're doing adaptive modulation, we're sending data, and we have new observations we can add into our database to update the learning classifier. And so that's supervised learning. And so then we developed a supervised learning method here that works more or less as follows. And so the machine learning based approach I talked about, you probe the channel, the receiver probes the database to figure out the suggested rate for the machine learning algorithm, sends the parameters back to the transmitter transmits the packet with recommended information. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to take that packet, the information from that, was it decoded correctly or not, decoding the modulation and the feature vector, and store that and use it. Now, the challenge with online learning is that the data you've got is continually accumulating. So obviously, you can't store all the data from all time. It wouldn't fit in your memory. And so you need a way of either storing the data or, when you take the data and updating your learning engine in such a way that you can still adapt to the environment, but you also don't want to, to store maybe measurements that are extremely old, and you don't want to throw things away too quickly either. And you also, even if you have an old observation, if it's something that's really interesting, you don't want to throw that away either. And so there's a bit of, I don't know what the right word here is, maybe kind of thinking, for lack of a better term, that goes into figuring out how to manage this data in such a way that you have enough interesting observations. And so you have to decide, okay, when do we throw data away? And then there's also the exploration and exploitation trade-off. So suppose your machine learning algorithm is working pretty well. The throughput seems good. The target error rate is being met. So maybe life is good, right? But maybe you could do even better. And so the engine has to at some point decide, well, okay, I'm not going to recommend the best rate. I'm going to try another one just to check to see how it goes, right? And so that's the exploration phase. And during the exploration phase, you may not operate at the highest spectral efficiency, but you get valuable information that will help you keep your classifier updated. You know, you can imagine this as like driving to work. You take the same route every day. Maybe sometimes you try a different route just to see, hey, was that one faster or not? So I think as engineers, we've all probably done that. So that's the exploration-exploitation trade-off. Now, the other thing to keep in mind is in a wireless system, you've got broadcast transmission. So you can also collect information from other people's transmissions. You know, if the access point is sending to a laptop over there with a certain coding modulation, I can overhear that and process it as well. Now, it's a little bit more tricky when you have pre-coding at the transmitter, because that pre-coding was designed for the other user's channel. And so in that case, maybe it won't be as useful. But if you have spatial multiplexing without the pre-coding, you could overhear it and maybe add that data into your database. So this is an example here of, this is a simulation where we looked at two cases here. So one, we have this standard lookup table, the one dimension, that's the best one, the ESM approach. And then our supervised learning approach. And channel trace index, that's over time. And data rate is the rate that we are achieving. Now these curves don't look very smooth because we have, you know, the channels changing slowly over time too. So it's not meant to be like a flat line. And the machine learning approach outperforms the lookup table. Now both of those approaches, the lookup table was designed under the assumption of no impairments. So then we ran it again with that RAP linear amplifier model. And that there, the lookup table approach broke down quite a bit. So it lost about a factor of two of performance, whereas our learning approach was able to do quite a bit better. Now, of course, it wasn't able to do as well as if there was no impairment at all, which is to be expected. But it still was able to get, the factor, 50 to 100% more in terms of throughput. So that's a simulation example. Now, one of the other things we did, so this was back in the early days of GNU Radio where people hadn't actually implemented MIMO yet, and there wasn't a whole lot of code and resources at that point. And so we built a MIMO system with the USRP GNU Radio. We, in collaboration with one of my colleagues, we used something called Click Modular Router, which would give us the MAC and higher layers so that we could do 11N type transmissions, including all the effects of the MAC, the retransmission, and so on. And so we implemented that, and then implemented that supervised learning, and it was really amazing that it actually works. Now I'm going to click this link here. We even, and I've always been telling my students that we have to make stuff, put things on
radio USRP and unit, and on the other side of the lab here, we have the same setup. One of these will act as a transmitter, and the other receiver. So now that I've explained the experimental setup, I'd like to switch over to a desktop.
The main focus of today's demonstration is applications of machine learning for rate adaptation in wireless networks. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to hit a switch that's going to enable a machine learning algorithm that's going to learn the features of the channel over time. It's going to learn the appropriate modulation and coding scheme to use. So that's actually what I've just done right now. And this is packet error rate on top and throughput on bottom. What we're seeing is that the algorithm hasn't had an opportunity to learn the features of the channel initially, so the packet error rate is going to be very high. But over time, we're going to see a decrease to 0.1, which is the constraint that we've built into the algorithm. We're also going to see throughput increase over time as well. So that's exactly what we're seeing. But what would you imagine would happen if I, say, unplugged one of the transmitters?
This is a sketch of the lab that we had at the time. The building has since been demolished and we have a new building, so I have no way to collect that data anymore again. And then what the students did was they put the transmitter and receiver on a rotating platform. Oscillating platform is short term for basically fan, so the fans oscillate, so we could take the fan off and put the platform on there. The reason they did that is that it turns out if you're in an empty lab, nobody's walking around, the channel doesn't vary that much. So I have another slide with the channel not varying, but this was one where it was varying. And we used the online learning, we compared with the offline learning where the weights were trained prior to the oscillation, and then the throughput as a function of time here. And so you can see that the offline learning never quite meets the packet error rate constraint because it just wasn't trained in the right kind of environment. The online learning after about 20 packets is able to converge to a solution that meets the packet error rate. And then the throughput very quickly gets up to about the maximum here, 80 megabits per second. And then what we compared with here, I didn't talk too much about the MAC, but The way link adaptation is actually done in many Wi-Fi type systems is to use something or some variation of auto rate fallback, which is basically you transmit at a certain rate. If you get a bunch of NACs, you change the rate lower. And if you get a bunch of ACKs, you increase the rate higher. And that concept works pretty well. It's actually it's fine in the CISO systems. The problem in MIMO is that up and down doesn't have a good interpretation because you also have antennas, right? So is up adding antennas or is up changing the rate of the modulation? But in any case, you can see the auto rate fallback is eventually converging to a higher solution, but it never quite gets to the solution we got with the online learning. So this is just an example of some of the works. I wanted to convey to you that machine learning is a powerful tool for solving real engineering problems. I mean, this was a problem that I worked on even as a PhD student when I was at this company, IOSBAN Wireless, and we were trying to just build the system and make it work, not trying to write papers, and it was hard. And so this actually solves that problem, and the cool thing is that it works. You can build the equipment, even if it's really crappy, the GNU radio stuff at the time, the RF left a lot to be desired, and yet, it would still work well. So some of the other extensions I didn't tell you about, we did at one point look at what if we changed the rate differently per stream. There wasn't a huge benefit in throughput, but there was a slightly different mathematical formulation. We actually have a nice series of work where we generalize this to an 11A AC type setup where there's also pre-coding and multi-user communication. And so the scheduling and the link adaptation are all tied together. And that's a really nice paper. There's some other conference versions of that as well. And then one of the limitations of what I showed you is that everything in the database, we had typically fixed length packets. So to predict the packet error rate, of course, the longer the packet, the more likely it's an error for the same channel. And so we developed some other mathematical approaches for approximating frame error rate given observations of variable length packets. And I have some other references here as well, just in case you're interested to check it out offline. Now, I'm going to tell you about what we're doing in millimeter wave beam training these days. So millimeter wave communication systems have been an exciting topic for at least 5 years. The main feature of millimeter wave is high bandwidth, thus high data rate communication. Now, the way that millimeter wave is being implemented in the early commercial systems, including like wireless HD, 11AD, they use something along the lines of as follows. Sometimes different variations of this, but it's the concept here. Basically, you have beamforming that's done in analog. And the reason is that because of the power consumption, you can't afford to have a high-dimensional digital MIMO system operating at gigasamples per second. And so in this case here, we have single stream beamforming here. So we have a large array. It could be 256 elements at the transmitter, possibly at the receiver as well. And then we do analog beamforming and analog combining. And by selecting those weights, form, in this case, a directed beam. And that beam points in some direction. And then one of the challenges, because the bandwidth is so high at millimeter wave, you cannot overhear the transmission without having any beamforming gain. And so the transmitter is trying to point in different directions. And then if you have multiple receive antennas, one thing you can do is try to listen in different directions. And then the hope is at some point, when the transmitter is talking and the receiver is listening, they find a common communication path that works well. And this approach is called grid of beams. And if you have like NTX transmit beams, NRX receive beams, you have to try all possible combinations. So if you have a lot of antennas, you have a lot of beams, there's a huge amount of overhead to synchronizing beams here. And this is similar to the initial access part of 5G, except that they don't do the search at the receiver, they do a refinement, similar to what's done in 11AD. Now I'm going to focus in this talk on this configuring the beams from one of a set of many beams. So I'm not going to look at the more complicated MIMO configurations. We have other work on that isn't leveraging machine learning at the time. So to give you an idea of the issue here, so this is a video created by Professor Kaltu, one of my collaborators. And what you can see is that as the beams, as you get more antennas and the beams get narrower, it takes longer and longer to scan to establish the link. And so you have this, we have this insight that from a communication perspective, having large arrays is good because that means the SNR is good, but then it takes too long to connect the beams. And in a mobile setting, then that overhead becomes substantial. So, okay. All right, yeah. And so why this is important is that the application I've been looking at most recently, millimeter wave, has been into vehicular systems. And so in automated vehicles have a lot of sensors. Unfortunately, most of those sensors are limited by line of sight, just like we are. So if you're behind a truck, your LiDAR cannot see through the truck. But if you have communication capability, you can discover what's around in the environment. And then the best way to do that, in my opinion, is to exchange raw information. Because raw information, the machine learning algorithms operating in every vehicle can just use the sensor data that's made available to them. You're not relying on the algorithms in another vehicle and how they process it. It also adds an element of security here. The problem is that you can easily get gigabits per second depending on what you share and how often. So millimeter wave has a lot of potential in the for enhancing automated driving, but the problems I just mentioned make it difficult to imagine that working because you're gonna spend so much time trying to point the beams and not enough time communicating. The observation is that in millimeter wave, V to X is what we call it, there's a lot of consistency in the way the system is working, right? So the cars are generally speaking, in their lanes, going in the typical directions. I know in some countries it's not always the case. But there's a lot of regularity. I mean, in the morning there's rush hour, there's many cars. Maybe in the evening there's many cars. Late night there's not as many. There's a lot of basically predictability here. And there's also a lot of site information because the vehicles have sensors and they're generating data as well. Now contrast that with a handset. You know, if you're doing millimeter wave at a handset, you have, how is the person holding it? Is their finger blocking the antenna? Are they blocking the antenna? Are they walking in sort of a strange way? So there's not a lot of predictability in how we communicate to that user, but there would be on the vehicles here. And so we wanted to look at this here, and then what is even more exciting are these site information opportunities. You know, so the way that you do beamforming probably is going to vary based on the time of day. You know, in Austin, I remember when I used to bike in the morning, and there were these roads that would always be blocked by these big trucks dropping off beer to the bars. And so when those big trucks are there, perhaps they're going to be blocking the millimeter wave communication. And then later in the day, of course, they're gone, and the people consuming the beers are there in the street. So, you know, the time of day is important, the traffic density. And there could even be similarity, you know. I mean, you could imagine a millimeter wave system that learns and figures out how to do the beam training at a particular intersection. And maybe those other intersections are similar. And so you can use that common information to improve training. And the vehicles itself, I mean, you might have site information about the position, the trajectory, the type of vehicle, the location, you know, okay, is this a truck? All that is potentially information that could be available here. And this is perfect for leveraging and machine learning. In particular, unlike what I showed you before, what's interesting here is that it's hard to figure out how to use the site information. You know, even if we just write this on paper, we say, oh, I don't believe in machine learning. You know, I don't know how to write like a Wiener filtering problem incorporating time of day, pedestrian density, traffic, and antenna location. I just don't know how to do that. And so machine learning is helping us use this information that as engineers we realize should be valuable, but we may not know exactly what to do with it. So one of the easy source of information in the vehicular setting is location. So cars are starting to be equipped with what's called dedicated short-range communication. And the key feature of DSRC is that cars broadcast a heartbeat message, their position and some other parameters 10 times a second. So you could have that information connected to a base station. The base station could be listening and saying, hey, there's cars here, here, and here, and here. I want to communicate with cars. Let me try to point a beam there. And so you can imagine the system working in different ways. I mean, it could be the car establishes communication with the base station and sends its location, and the base station says, great, this beam works, and then they start communicating. And that would work really well in free space. And the amount of overhead is low, because all the car has to do is just tell the base station where it is, or the base station can figure out from other information, and done. And so this is an example of what the overhead looks like here. The car is going, okay, admittedly a bit slow here, but no matter what the antennas are, you know, if you have good location information, you're able to point the antenna pretty well. And so you don't have to try all the possibilities. So it looks really good. And even for relatively large antennas, as long as your position information is accurate enough, you can point that well. Now, of course, at some point, you're going to get to a really small pencil beam, and then you hit the GPS in accuracy. But until you get to that point, I mean, the overhead is really minimal. But, of course, there's a problem, and you can figure that out because, just like when you're watching a movie, you know the movie's not at an end here. So the problem is that there's other users on the street, and there's also other stuff on the street. There's signs, there's obstructions. And so you can't guarantee line of sight all the time. And so maybe sometimes there's a truck that's blocking that communication beam. And so in this case here, then maybe you have to fall back to the other approach. So maybe you try line of sight, oh, that didn't work. And so then you just try all the possibilities and then figure out which one is the best. So that's what we already talked about here. And then just to give you an example, I mean, that, you know, the capacity is not labeled, but we did get this from simulations. And so here you can see that, you know, the line of sight is blocked a lot because you're in traffic and all the vehicles are moving in the same way. So line of sight beamforming, I mean, it's not working well, and clearly you would need non-line of sight here. So let's see here. So pause the video here. Okay, and so now back to the topic of the workshop, machine learning for communications. So we have this system here. So intuitively, look at the picture here. I mean, if we're in this location and there's no truck there, then we can use this line of sight communication beam, and that's probably the best one. But if that is blocked, then maybe we reflect onto that building. That building's not going anywhere. And so if I had this, if I was designing the system as a functional location, I might say, well, you know, if I could only try two beams, maybe I'll try this one and then that one if this one doesn't work. You know, and so the data-driven approach for beam training that we've proposed is to use a recommendation engine to suggest a few beams to try. So I don't necessarily want to try one beam because I know that some of the time that one beam is just not going to work. I don't want to find one beam that works most of the time because that one probably won't work well. But I want to try find a few beams such that with high probability one of them works. So I don't want to try three beams in the same direction. I want to try them in different places. But then based on past performance data that I understand that one of those is likely to work well. And so here the information is going to be position information and past performance data. So what was the SNR of that beam, or what was the rate that was achieved? And so forming beam alignment as a recommendation problem, so essentially, so in the training procedure like I showed you before, the car maybe on a low frequency link will say, hey base station, let's do millimeter wave together, here's my location. And so then the base station will figure out the combination of beams to try, and then it could send that to the user and say, here, you try these receive beams, I'm gonna try these transmit beams, something like that. Or it could try the transmit beams, the user could try its own receive strategy there. But the point is that you're getting a recommendation. And this recommendation concept is widely used in things like the Netflix problem, where you're logging into Netflix or Amazon too, and you see a movie, and then there's a whole bunch of other ones that says, hey, would you like to watch these? You know, and they're not necessarily all gory military movies like I've been watching recently. There could be some other stuff too. And, oh, hey, Star Wars. Oh yeah, actually, I'd like to watch that too, right? So it's trying to recommend things that are not necessarily too similar that it might be interesting and that you're likely to pick one with high probability. So we're using that same concept here, except we're also incorporating location. Now the difference with the typical Netflix problem is that in the Netflix problem, there's no notion of location there, and they're trying to figure out, find users that are similar. And this is more of an unsupervised type problem, whereas here, we're going to exploit the fact that cars, when they're in the same place, have similar kind of performance. And so this is just an example here of, let me find the pointer here, let's see. So, you know, you can see here that, so some of the times we're trying different beams, sometimes we reflect off the car, sometimes elsewhere here, and the net of it is that the overhead isn't really that high. It's not that much higher for large antennas, and we achieve a pretty good fraction of the rate. Now let's go to, let's see here, another example here. This is just like spectral efficiency versus overhead, so you can just see that the rate that's achieved actually becomes much better than if you were just naively using the line of sight beam, in the interest of time, I'll just keep going here. Let's see. I never had so many videos in a talk in my life, so this is really a new experience to click through them here. So the last few minutes, I'll just tell you about what we've been doing most recently. So that initial work was based on a concept that we called inverse fingerprinting, in deference to how multipath fingerprints were used for location. So in the most recent work that we've done, we took a slightly different approach and said, well, okay, so suppose that the base station in fact knows where all the vehicles are. And as a result, it also has a good idea of the potential blockages. And so instead of just knowing the receiver and trying lots of beams, we have a good idea of the beams that may be blocked, and so we can probably try one or just a few with high probability. And so we developed a simulator using ray tracing. We actually did this in before too. I didn't show the details of it, but you know, for machine learning, it's important how to generate the data. So we have it's using wireless insight. The cars are dropped in a particular way with gaps according to typical traffic distributions. There's a certain distribution, fraction of cars and trucks. And then you generate different drops of vehicles and compute the performance based on the best 25 rays that are found. You use that to generate a MIMO channel that we apply the analog beamforming on top of that with the different beams. And then that's how we compute the combinations of performance as a function of location. And then the problem becomes quite interesting, which is like, how do you encode this information? And so there's different ways to, even if you just have location of the car, do you encode it in Cartesian, polar? What we actually did is we used, So here in some of the work we use an occupancy grid, and this work we use something more like a polar coordinate system. And so we build our feature vectors from the information about the location of the vehicle, and then we construct that vector in such a way that relative to the receiver that we're targeting, we include the closer trucks and then the closer cars. So there's a little bit of, you know, hand engineering that went into doing that sorting in this particular application here. And so then we use the Cartesian coordinate system to describe the locations of the different vehicles here and the type. And then the approach that we took here, we used what's called a random forest, which is like, it's known as a bag decision tree. And it's essentially like a whole set of classifiers, and then use the different methods to try to pick good classifiers and use combinations of the classifiers here. And that approach turned out to work quite well for our setup. And that's probably the best non-deep classifier that's around these days. So in terms of our performance, we looked at two things here. One is we looked at the probability that the machine learning algorithm was able to suggest the beam that was the best of all of the possible ones. So in the code book, the best combination, that's what we call best. And then, so we're not talking about the line of sight beam without code book weights. And then the achieved throughput is the throughput that we achieve with the beam selected divided by the throughput achieved with the best set of beams. And then these are different classifiers that we tried here. And the random forest gave, in the end, the highest alignment probability. So 85% of the time, we were able to, with just the site information, to predict the best beam. And in the case I was showing you before, we were recommending like 8 beams. And now we're just picking the one beam. So 85% of the time, one beam is found perfectly. And we get almost all of the achieved throughput from that one beam because it's right most of the time. Now what's interesting is that this Bayes approach, which didn't pick the correct beam all that often, actually had a higher rate than some of the other approaches that picked the beam better. And so the interesting thing here is that the alignment probability is not necessarily a proxy for average rate, because the question is, like, if you don't pick the best beam, what beam do you end up picking? If you end up picking a beam that in any ways has high rate, that's fine, even though you were misaligned. And so some of these approaches result in beams suggested that end up having higher rate even though they're not actually the correct one. And that's something that's interesting that I'm still trying to wrap my head around how to deal with that. I mean, one approach would be to do something that's based on throughput instead of based on alignment probability. And then I have only a couple of slides left, but this is an example with alignment probability performance. So we looked at, okay, so if we just have the location of the user, what's the best that we could do? About 60%. And then we add the first lane of trucks. We add the second lane of trucks and so on. And you can see that, and then the number of vehicle locations in the feature is on the x-axis. So this is related to the length of the feature. Of course, every vehicle location has several parameters associated with it. And you can see that just adding even a couple vehicles, a couple trucks, gives us 80%+ alignment probability. And then we can add all the other trucks in that lane, and then we're gonna get about the same performance. And then we add all the trucks in the next lane, add all the cars, and then performance gets a little bit better. And then the intuition here is that, you know, we don't necessarily need the FAR information. The other thing I want to highlight here is we did a rate example here. And so we looked at the points where there was a line of sight, and we computed the rate that we achieved with line of sight beamforming, and then the rate you achieved in the non-line of sight points. So line of sight, we got about 1.5 bits per second. And then when we had a non-line of sight channel, that line of sight link was blocked, so of course it didn't work. What's strange is the next line here. So it turns out that the optimum pair in the line of sight samples, in fact, wasn't the line of sight beam. And the reason is that even though there's line of sight, in our simulation we had multipaths, in particular 25 arrays. And so the line of sight didn't necessarily result in the highest received energy. And having one that was maybe a little bit to the left or a little bit to the right actually will combine with the multipaths better and give a higher rate. So that was something that was strange I hadn't seen. And then the other thing was that, I mean, of course, in non-line of sight, then beamforming works better. So basically the message here was that line of sight beamforming, of course it doesn't work when there's non-line of sight, but it's not necessarily the best even if there's line of sight. So we have some extensions where we did multiple beams. In the interest of time, I'll skip that. These are some references that you can check out later, but basically there's the work on position-aided beam alignment, and that's what we did the last year. Some of it is still in archive, still under submission. The work with situational awareness is newer. The main results I just showed you here are going to be presented at the SPOT conference next month, and then we've also got some work with beam power and prediction. Some of this as well is available at the ITA conference. And there we have made the data set available. I'm hoping we'll have data sets for the other papers available too. It's taking a little bit of time to, you know, shake them out of students, but we should have them soon. So just to wrap up here, I've already gone over several minutes here, but just a couple perspectives. I mean, just if you think about this from a cellular point of view, you know, for machine learning, there's the classifier that you train. There's the data that you use to train, and then there's the algorithm in which you train it. And these are all potentially different things, and they could be located in different places in the network. And I'm actually not sure where they should be, and I don't know, a lot of people are using the Amazon Cloud for training, but I mean, I don't know if that's gonna be the case in cellular. I mean, it's maybe we use the learning to come up with an initial configuration, and maybe it gets updated slowly, maybe it's updated locally based on every base station, maybe the learning is applied across the network, we use the data from everywhere in the network. I'm not really sure, but I think there's a lot of opportunities to really think here about where the learning could be. There's the other thing I'm really excited about is the use of site information. And there's a nice paper here with Professor Maria Gonzalez-Prelchik that describes the role of out-of-band information in millimeter wave. You know, so position is a piece of information that didn't come necessarily from the comlink. You could have radar, LIDAR, cameras, as well, the base station, collecting information. And again, this is a problem of how do I use that in millimeter wave? I don't know, but hopefully a machine learning algorithm can figure that out. So I think there's a lot of potential there. We're looking at various approaches here, but many of them are not yet leveraging the machine learning perspective. And then finally, I guess every talk in this area has to mention something about deep here. I did have one paper with deep learning. So far, we haven't found that it is as useful for the problems we're talking about. I think because we've been able to, as engineers, design a reasonably low dimensional feature vector, so we just didn't need the approximation power of with the deep network here. That said, I mean, there's certainly a lot of potential, and I think in particular for incorporating the higher dimensional sensor data, I think deep learning can play an important role there. So, you know, just wrap up here and say, I mean, I think, yeah, you know, I've given you an approach on machine learning for the physical layer, but and just in MIMO and millimeter wave, but I think that anywhere there's a parameter, you look in cellular systems, there are so many parameters that are tweaked even differently for every base station, down tilt of the antennas, the power, the handoff thresholds. All of these are things that can be adjusted with machine learning algorithms. And of course, that many of the higher layers as well can benefit from learning and potentially in an even stronger fashion. So that'll stop. Take any questions if there's time.
So we are just a bit late, but less than expected, so it's great.
Oh, good. So I have five more minutes. Let me hear the backup slides here.
So we can take one or two questions. Quick question. Yes, please.
I was just thinking about robustness when you skipped over that slide. So I think it was one of your backup.
Like this one.
It's just the last slide. I think before the.
This one here.
Yes.
Yeah.
Could you just go over it.
Yeah, I've just mentioned here, I mean, that, let me see here. Sorry, the graph is really small even for me to read. So this is one beam, and this is like two beams. And then this was with a logistic recommendation. So having like, in this example here, three beams instead of one, we get 95% beam selection. 95% of the time the beam is selecting correctly. So, I mean, that's adding multiple beams improves substantially. Even just two, you can get 95%. So, then that's in the sense of, and then where the robustness comes is that, you know, so trying to couple is usually better than just relying on the first one because there's going to be inaccuracies. The trucks aren't exactly the right shape. So, having a couple extra is going to give you more robustness, let's say.
Yes.
Yes. You mentioned the problem of when to forget the past, but I didn't hear how you actually handled that.
That's a good question. I do not remember how we handled that. So that was something, you know, I mean, that we had implemented in the prototype, and there was just, you know, there was some mechanism for it, but I can't say. Okay. Recall. Okay. It was, you know, but it's probably in the dissertation, but, you know, that work was done in 2008, so I think.
Still an interesting open question.
It's still an interesting open question, potentially, and, you know, yeah, I don't remember what's in my students' dissertations 10 years later, I confess. Thanks.
When do you mean online learning? You mean it was reinforcement learning, right?
It was, yeah, I guess the reinforcement is the right, yeah, no, right term there. Yeah. Yeah, so it was reinforcement.
Okay, so thanks again. All right. Thank you.